Hello everyone. Today I bring to you a dialogue with a screenwriter and director in Hindi films and television. He's the maker of parallel cinema such as Mohan Joshi Hazir Ho, Albert Pinto Ko Gussa Kyun Aata Hai, Salim Langde Pe Mat Ro, and Naseem. He also made the popular TV serial Nukkad. Saeed Mirza reflects the ground realities of ordinary people, their struggles, their frustrations, the violence and corruption that surrounds them. And at the same time, he shows some of the tender moments and hopes and dreams of these people. Let us first have a look at some of the clips from his movies.
नाम क्या है तेरा?
अल्बर्ट पिंटो।
यू बास्टर्ड।
मैं कुत्ता नहीं हूँ, जिसे कुचला जा सके।
हम लोग सब यहाँ खड़े रहेंगे, ऐसी आंखें फड़-फड़ के टीवी देखते रहेंगे, और एक दिन हमारी माँ बिक्री होगी।
स्टॉप इट।
दिन दहाड़े खून करना पड़ता है, गला घोटना पड़ता है, तब जाके उसके कुछ पैसे मिलते हैं।
तुम मेरी प्रॉब्लम जानना चाहते हो? एक ऐसी दुनिया में रहना जहां मेरे सोचने और करने में बहुत फर्क है।
भाई मेरे को दंगे फसाद में नहीं पड़ने।
पता नहीं ये हिंदू दुल्हनों के स्टोव ही ज्यादा क्यों फटते हैं।
हमारे लिए बुरका और तलाक ही काफी हैं जफर साहब।
अब्बा, बंटवारे के वक्त आप पाकिस्तान क्यों नहीं चले गए?
क्यों भाई गंजू, आजकल तेरा धंधा क्या ठंडा चल रहा है?
क्या बोलेगा गुरु, कंपटीशन बहुत है, जिधर भी देखो उधर भिकारी भिकारी।
भी कोई मेरे को बोला कि अमेरिका वाला लोग लाखों किलो गेहूं चावल शक्कर समुद्र में फेंक देता, जानवर लोगों को खिला देता, ऐसा काय को?
अरे मार्केट में इतना माल आएगा तो भाव नहीं गिरेगा। पर
व्हेन सईद एक्सेप्टेड टू टॉक टू मी, I went through a series of his videos on YouTube. I'm already familiar with all of his movies. But I realized he's an author of several books. One book that really gripped me was Ammi, Letter to a Democratic Mother. It's an autobiography written in the tone of gratitude to his mother, but it also reveals the magnanimity, the democratic process, the curiosity that he inherited from his family. I'm going to read a couple of passages from the book. Okay, here is one where Saeed says to his mother, "You had said that people all over the world have an innate sense of what is good for them and what is not. It can never be imposed from the outside, but has to come from within. And that is why the Americans, instead of bombing and killing and destroying like elephants in a sugarcane field, should just get out and leave those people alone." There's another very interesting incident from the book, where Nusrat, Saeed's father, is being interviewed by the family because he has asked to marry their daughter. Nusrat says to them, "I'm on the side of change." They needed to know more. To make his point about change, he gives example of Kemal Ataturk. He says, in one stroke, he has changed the destiny of his people and his country. Let me read. "That is the world I have gambled on. That is the world I believe will shape the future. We have a choice. Do we want to live in a well from which we can only see a patch of the sky? Or do we want to live outside the well and see much more?" He is asked, "Do you believe in Allah, Nusrat Beg?" "I do," he says. "I certainly do. Then why do you take up for that Turk? Nusrat replies, because he believes in Allah too. But he was tired of seeing foolish priests harm the progress of his country. How can Islam harm progress? Nusrat replies, not Islam, but some of its interpreters can. Look how far back we have fallen from the achievements of Ibn Sina and Ibn Rushd. They were great scholars of Islam. Al-Ghazali was an eminent religious scholar amongst the best that Islam has produced. But Ibn Sina and Ibn Rushd went beyond him to include the study of science, mathematics, and philosophy. The reason I read some of these extracts from his book is because this book gave me the sense of the environment in which Saeed's parents shaped his critical thinking. It also brings focus on the misconceptions about Indian Muslims and Islam. Let's have a conversation with Saeed Mirza about the source of his curiosity and creativity, his interpretations of present-day India, and his hope for the future. So, assalamu alaikum, Saeed.
Wa alaikum salam.
So, I'm very happy to meet you. I do want to start with a very interesting question. I want to have a few comparisons. So I was reading your book. I saw, your videos that you have this leftist belief, but you also have an appreciation and curiosity for Sufi philosophy. So how do they both coexist in your imagination?
For a very simple reason, Uday, I'm not a communist.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a Marxist. And Marxism to me is poetry. The idea of it. I mean, it is economics, of course it is. But it is to find the poetry in the lives of ordinary human beings and to give them their dignity and their poetry of living. And to me, that's critical. It's not a harsh representation of just pure economics. It is to find poetry and give meaning to the lives of people. And people should find their poetry. That's what it's all about. Mm-hmm. So therefore, I do not find it a contradiction between Sufism or Bhakti, the Bhakti tradition. Namdev and Tukaram are as socialist or Marxist as anybody can be.
And Kabir as well.
And Kabir and Bulle Shah, mm-hmm, and Nanakji. And the point I'm getting at is that the first Marxist was not Karl Marx, it was Gautam Buddha. So if you see the journey of man in a certain kind of way, of the struggle to give meaning to the lives of people, to make a world less and less iniquitous, less and less unjust, more humane, more compassionate, more inclusive, and that's been the journey of man. Marxism has given it a kind of a very strong economic empirical thrust. But it's also, to me, it is to bring back the idea of poetry.
Absolutely.
So therefore, there's no contradiction in me.
Yes.
To me, I find a great thing, like, how much more Marxist can you get when Zahid Sharab Peene De Masjid Mein Baith Kar?
Absolutely.
Ya woh jagah dikha de jahan khuda na ho. I mean, how more laconic can you get?
Absolutely. And the reason I asked also is because having seen and lived with and having had conversations with Marxists of all hues, from Gandhians at one end and Naxalwadis at the other end, I've seen that there were like two kinds of flares to Marxists that I have met one who were very militant in both their thoughts and expression, and the ones who were militant then in their ideas, but gentle and graceful in their utterances.
Right.
And I don't necessarily see a contradiction between them. I love both of them. And I never even like, I remember when my mother was in Bombay politics, I'm trying to remember her. There was one Naxalite woman. I forgot her name. Was it Sundar Nawalkar? I don't know.
Sundar
Nawalkar. I think so. But anyway, so there was a Naxalized woman who was working with her. Then there was Ahilya Rangnekar, who was a CPM.
Yes, I hear. Yeah.
And then there was Mrunal Maushi, and there were my mother. And even with them were a couple of BJP women also. And nobody, they all worked together. They all worked for causes of ordinary people. And I see that kind of a ethos going away now.
You know, because I'll tell you what the problem is, sir. The problem is history is littered with the corpses of good intentions. And when I say this, I'm sure there are a lot of members of the RSS and the BJP who actually believe that they are there for the good of the people of India.
Mm-hmm.
So also with ISIS. They are there for the good of the Muslim Biradari. They are there. And that is the problem now.
Mm-hmm.
Can you see the problem?
Absolutely.
That's the problem.
Yes.
Because they have not understood something which is very simple. Beyond the nature of caste, creed, and religion. And religion. When you declass yourself, it has to be through all three. And then you arrive at a certain kind of humanity. It says, workers of the world unite. Not just India. That's the Marxian theory. It's beyond this. And within the idea of Marxism, I think to me, I have, like a lot of people tell me, I've got some wonderful friends in the RSS. I say, sure, I'm sure they are. But tell me, what is the role of organizations like the RSS and communal riots? There's slaughter and mayhem over there.
Yep.
At the street level, people die. At another level, you've got Sanatan Dharma, which is philosophical, Vedantic. It's wonderful. It's an idea. At the street level, people die. I'm trying to understand this problem. It's the same with ISIS. The same problem is over there. They will use the Quran, and they will talk about the Sunnah for the Muslim.
Yeah.
What about the Sunnah? Why not the Jew? Why not the Hindu? Mm-hmm. Why not the Christian? Why not the African, the Black African? Why not the pagan?
Absolutely.
Why not the Japanese? So therefore, when this view is constricted, I've got a problem with that thinking. All the time, I am in my soul an Indian and an internationalist simultaneously.
Yes. But at the same time, when I go back to your book, I think what is missing is the curiosity of Nusrat Beg that's described in your book.
Yeah,
I think that curiosity and openness to learn from different books, different ideas and thoughts and not being indoctrinated by Islam, but respecting Islam as a way of being.
Yeah, you respect Islam, you can respect Hinduism, Christianity, Judaism, I don't know, Taoism, Buddhism, respect it. But for God's sake, go beyond it also simultaneously.
Yeah.
Because all said and done, ideas are beyond nomenclatures, far beyond. And so to me, that's important.
So my curiosity is, where did your dad's such intense curiosity come from? Did you ever ask him?
I did. It came from the fact that, you know, when he saw, it's there in the book. He says, when you wallow in obsolete poetry of romance, and it's got nothing against the idea of romance, but there is a world changing around you simultaneously, and you've got to reflect it, and you've got to understand it, and welcome it.
Yes.
Welcome it.
Absolutely.
And therefore, there's a problem now. When you welcome it, automatically a certain part of your world is going to get upended. Welcome it.
Yes.
It's going to be upended. And then you'll be asking yourself all kinds of questions. Why? And welcome it. Point is, don't defend the indefensible.
Absolutely. And what I really found fascinating was that even when he expressed that he was for change and that he was curious about Kemal Ataturk.
Yeah.
And the family who was interviewing him was a little cautioned. Still, your grandfather finally listened to your mother's wish.
It is strange.
And I'm amazed. He was a devout Muslim.
Yeah, absolutely.
He was surrounded by very conservative people. And he gave his daughter's wishes primacy.
Absolutely.
And so I'm so intrigued and inspired by that moment.
This is what I'm trying to say. We can reach a level of poetry despite a circumstance. What I'm getting at, I'll tell you a story. I made a documentary on the rickshaw pullers of Jabalpur many, many years ago, and it won the national award for the Madhya Pradesh government and won the national award. So there was a press conference that was being held. And the press people started coming in, you know, in bush shirts, pants, shirts, etc. And one gentleman walked in, long hair, tikka, kurta, dhoti. In my head, I said, the problem is going to be from here. The questioning process will be from here, because my film had turned in a certain kind of way. And surprisingly, the same gentleman was the most open, despite the other people in bush shirts and pants and shirts, a man who was so traditional, in quotes, and the most open-minded. From here comes an idea. What happens to a person who goes to a mandir and prays? What's the problem? As a Marxist, why do you hold it against him? Why do you hold something against a person who prays five times a day? What do you have a problem with a person who goes to a Buddhist and prays? I have no problem with that. I might not do it myself, but that is separate. And that is the poetry I'm talking about. It's a larger idea, a much, much larger idea. Unfortunately, when you're tunneled with a tunneled vision, you turn fascist. It's a very thin line.
I think the other thing that I learned from your book also is that, to your point, what you just explained, is that we need to accommodate and allow for other perspectives to coexist. And if somebody needs God or Buddha or, you know, Muhammad or Jesus or whoever,
absolutely,
Krishna, let them have. For me, I used to be, in my young days, I used to vehemently fight that there is no God. And then I realized that I've come to a realization that when I studied social sciences, that I can explain the concept of God in social imagination as a metaphor.
Right.
And for me, it's a linguistic metaphor. For somebody, it's a entity. And I'm absolutely okay with they need it. But I can have my own conceptual entity that
I also simultaneous God. And also simultaneously there without feeling superior about it.
Yes.
Because suddenly say, okay, let me, I will allow them their God, but they do not know any better. That's not the issue.
Absolutely. So that takes me to another very interesting story from my life, and you can comment on that. When I graduated from National Institute of Design, Ahmedabad,
okay,
my first job was in Lucknow. And there, I heard the phrase Ganga Jamna
Tehzeeb.
And that fascinated me. And that was 1981. So things had not gone so violently conflicted at that time. There was still Tehzeeb. I used to attend Mushairas. You know, I used to walk around in Lucknow and shop around, go to Charbagh and, you know, eat in like really roadside restaurants. And there was a beautiful culture that I had the firsthand experience. So what is your view on this Ganga Jamna Tehzeeb, and is it still there?
Ganga Jamna Tehzeeb, sir, was actually a revolution. It destroyed the power of Sanskrit and Persian. You know what that means?
Yes.
The power base of a language. And those guys who wielded that power are going to be incredibly angry. Incredibly angry of what has happened to their power base. And simultaneously, that journey of 700 or 800 years of a certain kind of rule, and this churning and the emergence of all kinds of subaltern languages are emerging in this vast land. Subaltern languages, Hindi, Kariboli, Bhojpuri, Dakkani, Marathi, Gujarati, Telugu, Bengali. All these languages are taking shape and form, and the language of the subaltern is coming to the surface. Look at the revolution that's happened. And who's going to be most annoyed about this? Yes. You have your answer today.
Yes.
You have your answer now. Who are the guys? You've got your answer over there.
Yeah. In fact, two, 3 days ago, I was having another dialogue. And so the person told me that she has friends from RSS who have told her that they have lost friends. So it's as much as I have lost friends during, I would call it this, Modi era or the RSS era, I see that even people who are on the other side who bought into this new ideology are losing friends. So do we care for the friends who we lose? And are friends the most precious possession that we have, running after some strange ideologies?
It's like saying, sir, I have a friend who was a Nazi. He's a friend. What would you do now? What would you do? Answer the question honestly. Because we've got a history. We have a given history. There is a history and what they did. Now, figure it out. To say I had a friend who was a Nazi, he was a friend.
That's true.
I have... I forgive, but I do not forget. That Nazi would not be my friend. Ever. I will not... In a court of law, I will not point him out or her out. I will not. But he or she will never be a friend of mine. Because I know where I draw the line. I draw the line on any kind of bigotry. Any kind. I draw the line. I will accept everything else. To hate another human being because of his race, color, skin, religion.
Unacceptable.
Totally unacceptable. Completely unacceptable. That's it.
So I have a question, counter question to that. Since you took Nazi analogy, what do you do when an entire population begins to subscribe to fascist ideology and starts persecuting other people? How do you restore the sanity of the population while still treating the hardcore fascists as unacceptable, not friends?
Fascism finds its roots in despair. In despair. Surprisingly, so does Marxism, in a strange way.
Mm-hmm.
But the point I'm getting it at is, its roots come from the idea of despair of a given social economic circumstance. And there are no easy answers to explain how that has come to pass. And in the social, economic, and political circumstance in which we live, the best solution for a regime that wants to maintain power is through being fascist, to find the answer. They always have the answer. There's no questioning process. You require the other to pin the entire blame, historical, political, economic, put the bloody blame on somebody. In India, it's either Nehru or the Muslim. Shove it down their throat. The problem, Uday, every single year, as you and I are speaking now, every single year, approximately 12 to 15 million young people are passing out from the 10th, 12th, and graduation. Every single year, year after year. And they've all seen the good life on television and they all are aspirational where they're going to turn for jobs. Well, so also in Pakistan, so also in Bangladesh, so also in Nigeria, so also in Brazil. India has the problem magnified, but the point is the same. This can never be solved, this problem, because the economic and political situation that we find ourselves in can never solve this problem. It can never. We are in a system that means it cannot solve the problem. That's the truth. So where will this energy go now? Where will it be channeled? And who's at the helm of affairs who will decide to channel this? I can't let through this way. And that's the problem. It can be channelized through the idea of hate, the other. Islam khatre mein hai. Hindutva. Because there is no choice. That's the problem. That's the issue. And I don't know how. I don't know how capitalism has been linked with democracy. I can't. It's a philosophical
contradiction.
What has capitalism got to do with democracy? The Soviets tried to use it and said workers are the ones and that's democratic. Even that was no way. No way. Then what is democracy really all about? It's a back we've got to figure out and find out. It will not be solved with the economic and social system and political system that we have. That's the truth. Neither in America nor in India. The writings on the wall are there. Where do you live? Where do you live in America?
I live in San Francisco.
San Francisco. Now, when 60% of Americans live from paycheck to paycheck, you've got a problem on your hands.
Yep.
You call that democracy? The land of the free and the brave? Land of milk and honey? Who are we fooling? You are run by oligarchs.
Absolutely.
So, we are run by but the oligarchs here too and get bypasses. The problem is here. We are fooling ourselves. We are deluding ourselves into democracies. None of us are democratic, in a sense. The tragedy is a state capitalism in China is far more democratic. And I don't like the state of China at all. That's separate. It has achieved something somewhere. But at what cost? That's also true. So I'm trying to see a lot of things simultaneously there. In this act of creation, of trying to write, to make films, to understand this world my grandchildren are inheriting, I've got a problem.
So
when I'm trying to make a film.
So since you mentioned this, I have a question here. So today, in today's environment, I can clearly see that a movie like Kashmir Files fills up theaters.
Perfect. But
do you still think there's an audience for your kind of films?
Frankly, I don't know, and nor do I give a damn. I'm just chronicling my times. I'm trying to chronicle my times. My films are not films, they're essays. I'm chronicling my times. And I see the writing on the wall. My last film, Naseem, is the writing, the epitaph of my country. I wrote the epitaph of India. The poetry is over. Now we have hate. And that's it. Because India was an idea. And there was poetry.
So was that your swan song or do you still have a
swan song
coming?
Swan song. Then I started traveling and writing about exactly this. Exactly this. And not just India. I'm trying to see a world simultaneously there. We've gone wrong. We've gone all right. We have lost our bearings as human beings. Beyond Islam and Hinduism, bakwas, you know, let's go. We'll find our own way, you know, but we've gone wrong somewhere. And we are trying so hard. And then you've got these specialist gurus. God damn it, because so many gurus, they're coming out of the building woodwork now in India. They're all there. Pontificating to whom? To the elite.
So
and also in Pakistan, also I'm not sure, also in Brazil, I don't know.
So I have some thoughts I want to share with you.
Right.
And I would like to seek your response to it. So for the past 1 year, I've stopped working and I'm just meeting people, talking to them, listening to them. I'm sharing my poetry with them because I think poetry is a very powerful tool for getting people to reflect and have a dialogue. So 1 year I've been just moving around. I was in Cochin, Pune, Mumbai, here in the US in many places. And I keep organizing poetry reading sessions online. And through all these experiences, I have come to see a little crack in the door. I'm feeling hopeful that what the world needs, we can, no system, political system is going to serve us. I think we need to work at, I need to work at a ground level to create curious, compassionate, and collaborative, creative people. So I call it like curiosity, compassion, and co-creation as the foundation of what I want to cultivate. And in that, I want to create a future that is just based on caring and sharing. And I think for that, I can't rely on any system, any ideology. I just need to talk to people one-on-one in small groups and see if I can just open their minds to be more curious. What are your thoughts?
Every wretched NGO today in the world is trying to do the same thing.
No.
Every NGO in the world, and these philanthropists keep putting money into the NGOs. And you've got Oxfam, and you've got something else, and you've got something else, and you've got NGOs in India and abroad, and everyone's NGOs. What are they trying to do? They see a world going all right, and they're trying their best to sort of stem the tide of what's going wrong. You have to have a political system of governance which in its soul should be compassionate, inclusive, and democratic. Tough journey. Tough journey.
Do you believe, knowing the India that you know?
No, not India. It's also the world. We are a small planet.
You
can start with India. But what I'm saying is, we require one step, but it's going to be political. Then one step at a time, working continuously. And the end is, there's no end. There's no target by 2045 or 20. That's not the problem. That's not the issue. That's not the problem. By 2090, that's not. The point is to understand the fact that the human being is important and not just a few. And the alternative is get rid of 90% of the population and rule the world. Destroy. Eliminate. Wipe them out. What are you going to do? And who decides that there's a problem with that? There's a problem.
I truly believe what you're saying is that the disease, the mental disease we have of hatred, that is worse than even COVID right now.
Oh, yes, absolutely.
And this, not is just this is worldwide.
And not just that, it is to recognize that the answers are political. The answers lie in a political and economic system that govern people's lives and make them, because you cannot have, I don't have the answer, I only have the question. But I do believe we need, and it's going to be step by step by step, because it's going to go against the grain of whatever exists. right now, slowly, but work slowly towards a more equitable, compassionate, inclusive world, beyond caste, creed, color, religion, and bring back poetry into the lives of people. There's so much despair all around.
I have a question for you here. I'm going to tap into your creative imagination.
Right.
I want to hope and I want to help work towards that future of that political transformation that will happen. Hopefully in my lifetime, probably not. Can you imagine like a storyboard of how it is triggered and who's involved in it? And what are the qualities and contours and a zeitgeist of such a transformation taking place?
There's a song sung by Mr. John Lennon. Imagine.
Imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try. No hell below us. Above us only sky.
The words of the song, it seems at times so difficult, and it's true. And if you hear the words of the song, it is an attempt. It is an attempt of a world governance, a world rather than seeing ourselves as Brits and Americans and Russians and Chinese and Nigerians, but to see a world, we're caught up in it's one small planet over there.
I know.
one planet.
Do you feel your creative juices ready to write the script of such an event?
No, I'm too old now. I'm too old, but I'll tell you, I believe that as you and I are speaking to each other today on the 15th of September, you in San Francisco, I in Goa, there must be at least 50 million young people across the world asking a question, where the hell are we going? The world. And that's the hope. That's the hope.
That's good. In fact, I'm so happy to hear that despite your anger and disappointment with where the mass is headed, you still have hope.
100%. Otherwise, I'll be boom. No, hope. Of course there's hope. When I meet young people, and young people today in India, my God, they are doing stuff. They are taking on this bloody regime. They are taking on orthodoxy. They are taking on these bloody fanatics of all hues. They are taking them on. What path they will choose, I'm not so sure, but it doesn't matter. At least they're thinking and they're asking questions. That's important.
And where do you see them? Their voices, their imagination, does it manifest online? Does it manifest in streets, in theater?
Yeah, and where does it manifest? Also, you know, I have, for some strange reason, a lot of those young people do get in touch with me. For some strange reason, because of the film that I made about the future and I did it in the past. They all say, my God, he's like an oracle. I'm not an oracle. I just had my ears to the ground and I was recording. So they think that, you know, but yeah, lots of them. By the thousands, hundreds of, in India. And they are there. And they are trying very hard to. But the forces aligned against them have a lot of money, a lot of power. The battle is on with it. The battle is on.
So I have one more question. So in your book, you referred to Mullah Nasruddin.
Yeah, my God, what a character.
Yeah, so tell me a little bit more about like what intrigues you about Mullah Nasruddin.
He was all that is irreverent in Islam. He represented the ethos of revolt against orthodoxy, compartmentalized visions of a world, tunneled vision of the world, unquestioning belief. And he was a figure of complete irreverence and respected throughout Islam and hated by the high and mighty. But he was an idea. So when you had something to say about Islam, I didn't say so. Mullah Nasruddin said so. I mean, this is a story of his. So the point is, he was a figure, irreverent, iconoclastic, and he was there. You know, I'm amazed by the stories of Mullah Nasruddin, and he was quite a character. Whether he's real or not is unimportant. He's a fiction of people's imagination to revolt.
And what's the significance of putting him on a donkey?
Because that is the most in Islam. The second Khalifa, Umar, when the Islamic army started conquering the world, he came on a donkey onto Jerusalem. They expected a guy come with a big, you know, he came on a donkey. And that idea of the donkey and the idea of a donkey, the donkey is hardworking, unflinchingly hardworking and unquestioning. But a great animal. It's a great animal. And it's a part of, I don't know, the
I found it very intriguing, that whole episode in your book. So now, I have also,
Ibn Sina, yes, coming through the book, you know, the whole journey. I'm putting these as markers.
Yes.
Markers through the book. They are the journey of mankind.
Absolutely.
I put them as markers.
So I have one last question, which goes back to your story in your book. That moment when Amanullah Khan decided that he's going to listen to his daughter, what do you think was going on in the matriarch's mind?
I don't know. She couldn't control her son. So she would have perhaps wanted to. Couldn't control her son. But, you know, these are journeys of...
Do you think she would
have... By the way, my new book is out in America. Please have a look at it.
Yeah.
It's called I Know the Psychology of Rats.
Yes, it's about Kundan Shah.
And me. It's published by the Columbia University Press. Have a look at it.
I have a hypothesis that matriarch would have somewhere in the corner of her mind thought, Jahanara deserves a future that I wish I had.
Yeah, maybe, perhaps. And you know, the idea of that when Jahanara says, Kune ki mindak, the frog in the well, it's so comforting. You know things.
Absolutely.
The moment you step out, here's another world, and you're so uneasy, you're so uncertain. And that's the problem with mankind, and you're uncertain. Your comfort zones, your caste system, your religion, Islam, khatre mein hai, and Hinduism and Hindutva. I mean, it's so pathetic, it's sad. Because it requires a release. And the tragedy is that in Islam, maybe caste system hai. Caste system hai, Islam maybe. Wo kehte kuch bhi.
You mean Islam outside of India or Islam within India? Because I know it exists.
In India, bahar bhi, I'm not so sure. I'm not so sure, but perhaps bahar bhi. Maybe it'll be a class system as opposed to a caste system, an India caste system.
So I have a hypothesis now, after listening to you, after reading your book, that yes, there needs to be a political transformation, but in order for that to happen, many of the people who have the potential to participate in that change need a voice like Rukhsana, who gently prods Jahanara to think of, to provoke her curiosity.
Yeah. And and also I believe this movement, if we see it as a political movement, should be initiated by men and women from the most oppressed sections of society, because they have experienced a historical pain that none of us can imagine. We can empathize with it. And that journey should begin from there. Who are these men and women around the world? I don't know. And they should be, because it cannot be led any longer by the ruling elite.
No.
It's got to be led. And I will follow.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
It's got to be led by people who have been through the grind historically, and they have.
To your point, I want to make a last comment and then we will end this conversation. I was talking to Martin McCowan. I don't know if you heard about him.
Mm.
Himself a Dalit, and he works with Dalits in Gujarat. And he told me that one of his initiatives is to give fantasies and dreams to Dalit children, so they have the fuel and the will and the motivation to work towards a future that doesn't bind them to their reality also.
Oh,
so he writes storybooks also for Dalit children to give them that kind of a flight of imagination.
I'm on his side.
Wonderful. Saeed, thank you so much. I really enjoyed talking to you, and your book has been an eye-opener. I will read all the rest of your books as well.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Khuda Hafiz.
Khuda Hafiz. Namaskar. Jai Hind.
बड़े शहर की एक गली में बसा हुआ है नुक्कड़ नुक्कड़. करके सारे बाशिंदे तकदीरों से बदतर।
अलग अलग तकदीर है सबकी, अलग अलग है बोली, अपने अपने धंधे सबके अपनी अपनी टोली।
अजब तमाशा है ये नगरी, दुख में हंसते गाते हैं,
अपनी बर्बादी का यारों ये तो जश्न मनाते हैं।